Thank you. Good morning, everybody, and yeah, may the 4th be with you. The Internet of Textile Things, I hope to bring people to this stage. Yeah, and I expected everybody to be here, especially at this time. I'm very happy that you are here. So let me introduce myself. I am René Bohne from Aachen and Berlin. I was introduced, or I was invited as the founder of Wear LEDs. I'm still with Wear LEDs, but now I'm also the business unit manager at Elektor. Who of you knows Elektor? One guy in the audience? Two. Okay, three. This is not enough, since Elektor is the leading electronics journal, magazine, for more than 60 years now. I will talk more about it later. But I'm also in a role here as a computer scientist. I'm a master in computer science and a PhD candidate at RWTH Aachen University. And my research is about personal design and personal fabrication. So this means 3D printing at home, laser cutting at home, digital fabrication at home. So my research question is, if you have a 3D printer that you can buy in the supermarket, what would you do with it? And for you wearable people, especially, how can we do wearables with 3D printing? I was the Fab Lab manager for 6 years in Aachen. It was Germany's first Fab Lab. And I will talk more about it later. I'm the vice president of Freie Maker e.V. This is a German association for makers. So if you join the Maker Fair in Berlin or in Hannover, or even go out here to the gig maker space, makers are the future. And my mission is to bring the maker community to Germany, or to support it in Germany. And I'm also an author for Heise, for Make magazine, at D. and O'Reilly. And those are two books that I wrote in the past. Making Things Wearable was the first book about DIY wearables in German. So you see the lily pad Arduino and everything that comes with it, LEDs, sensors. How can I build my own textile sensors? It is out of print, but if you need a copy, send me an email. We are writing a new book. I will talk about this later. And the second book that I have in print at the moment is, with many friends, Licht und Spaß, Light and Fun. And it is a book about craft and electronics. So how can we have fun with LEDs, with light in general? So here you will also learn how to use an Arduino, how to use a soldering iron, and how to have fun with it. And now Elektor, the famous magazine for 60 years, it is about electronics. And since nobody here knows it, it shows me that it is too old. The content is not up to date, and I want to change this. So wearables will be a big topic at Elektor. We don't only have this magazine, it's a printed magazine that comes out almost every month. And we also have this online community, Elektor Magazine. And here you can see we have a category for wearables. So news about wearables and wearable technology, fashion tech. You can participate, upload your own projects, and get some visibility in the internet. And we also select the best projects and put it in our printed magazine. So if you're a fashion designer or electrical engineer, look and check out the new Elektor page. It's brand new, and we hope that everybody has fun. Now let's talk about my research at RWTH Aachen University. I told you before, I was the manager of the Fab Lab for 6 years, and the Fab Lab is a fabrication laboratory. In Berlin, we have a very big Fab Lab. We have more than 350 Fab Labs worldwide. A Fab Lab is a place where you can go for free. Maybe you pay a little money for the materials, or per hour, but usually it's free, to use the 3D printers, laser cutters, CNC milling machines. They have Arduino. And the most important thing is they have people. So if you have a question, how can I do DIY wearables, come to the Fab Lab. It's in every city. Yeah? In every bigger city in Germany now we have a Fab Lab. And we created in Aachen two very famous projects. One is the Fab Scan. The FabScan is a 3D scanner that was created by Franci Engelmann as a bachelor thesis. Then Mario Lucas now, he's also a famous maker, maybe you know Mario Lucas. Mario did the new FabScan Pi, so we ported everything to the Raspberry Pi. And this means you can scan any object and print it again. So for your wearables, you could use this. You don't have to be a 3D designer. You don't have to use a CAD software. You can use the FabScan Pi, scan it with your smartphone. So the operating interface, the user interface is a mobile interface. And you, on the left side, you can see the old box. On the right, you see the community creates amazing designs like this black and golden FabScan Pi housing. It is open source, so you download it and you assemble it. It's very cheap. If you have the spare parts, it's almost nothing. And the result is very good. The parts are printable, so you can download it in STL file format directly for your 3D printer. And this screenshot here shows you a very famous 3D printing slicer. And this can send the scanned rubber duck or the other object that you want to scan directly to your 3D printer. So this is brand new. We will release it to Maker Faire Hannover, I think, in 2 weeks. It is already online, but you can't really assemble it right now. But in 2 weeks, everybody can join the community. We will show you how to assemble it. It is very easy, and it is for your home. The other important project that I supervised was VisiCut, user-friendly laser cutting. So when you go to a fab lab and use a laser cutter, you can, for example, fabrics, you can engrave them, you can cut them very precisely and with high speed and high quality. And VisiCut is an open source software that we created just to make it even simpler, to make it easier in order for your projects you can share it, you can download objects and share it with the community. We have this Facebook integration now. We have Thingiverse integration. Thingiverse is a place where you can download 3D objects and other objects, or you can upload things. So very important to myself, to me, is how can we as a community help each other? Yeah? If you have a nice design, please share it, and VisiCut helps you. If you are not a designer, but you need to create a T-shirt, download VisiCut. It's open source, it's free, and use it with a laser cutter in the Fab Lab. Fab Lab Berlin uses it, Aachen, every Fab Lab has VisiCut. So this was about my research, and it had nothing to do with the Internet of Things, although all the objects live in the Internet, and they all have to do with things, but not really with the Internet of Things or textile things. So let's have a look at wearables. This is LumiNet. It was my diploma thesis in Aachen. It's an interactive organic illumination network. So it is a jacket with 80 LEDs, and they are all connected to each other. And as you can see, or can you see it? Yeah, we use duct tape. Yeah, we can't sew. Sewing is really not our hobby. We are computer scientists. We can't even hold scissors. So we grabbed duct tape and glued everything together. And even inside, we use duct tape and wires. So this is not really what you would expect if somebody talks about fashion tech. Yeah, this is not really fashion unless you have an interesting taste. But it works, and it still works. This means from 2009, when we created two of those jackets for Burning Man, it's still operating. Yeah? So wires are not the worst solution, even they look ugly. If you can hide them, you should use wires. The other problem that you have at Burning Man with a jacket like this, you have 80 microcontrollers, and you want to change the code that is running on each of those little LumiNet microcontrollers. You can't reprogram every single one of them with an ISP programmer or whatever you would use. So I created the programming by infection algorithm. This is a distributed bootloader. You have in your pocket, you have a vector node, a special LumiNet node that you just attach to the jacket, and like a virus, it spreads over the whole network. So it's programming by infection. But still, you might wonder, is this fashion tech? In 2009, I think it was. Today, I don't like the luminette notes anymore, and for this reason, we created the wear LEDs. Those are iron-on LEDs. As I said, I don't like sewing. So ironing is okay, and this is these are the prototypes, three luminette notes that you can iron on your shirt, on your skirt. It's very easy. And as you can see, it's just a tiny LED with a 3D printed housing and four copper legs, very thin. So you can easily hide it in your fashion project and you can cut it to size. If the legs are too long, cut them short and iron them on. This is how it works. This illustration shows it has three basic parts. It has plus and minus, yeah, for your supply voltage, your supply power, and it has a data line, and it's a bus system. This means every single LED can be controlled individually. You can have every LED can show a different color and brightness, and you can do animations in real time. So if you know the NeoPixel that Adafruit has in the shops, this is the same, but very flat, and we can iron it on. Of course, you also need a microcontroller. In this illustration, we used a 5 volts Arduino, for example, LilyPad Arduino you could use, or even a smaller microcontroller. Here's a photo of the actual prototype. You see the three lines of conductive fabric. So this is fabric that we ironed on. And in this picture, you don't see the final wear LED, but this is a prototype that used conductive glue, which is also better than sewing. Yeah? So you use conductive tape that helps you to just glue on our LEDs. You don't need iron. You don't have to use a soldering iron. And you don't have to sew everything. So this is very nice for a prototype. If you just want to go to a party and need your T-shirt for a few hours, then this is a good solution. It's not for eternity. In this picture, you see how we use the wear LED. It shines through the fabric so that the people don't have to be exposed to the direct light of the LED because they are very bright. So you should use it as shine through the textiles. Yeah? You can put a cover over your LEDs. And on the right side of the picture, you can see the microcontroller. It's very tiny, the size of your thumb. And this makes it very wearable. If you compare this solution to our luminette, it is light years better. It is really, it does the same. You don't have to program the nodes because you have one microcontroller that controls everything. And now, let me show you two examples how we implemented it. There was one dress by Lina Vasong. She's also over there with her latest collection. And our first project was the silver dress, and it visualizes your heartbeat. So we had a heartbeat sensor and many LEDs, many wear LEDs that just visualize your heartbeat. And on the left, you can see a jacket for a man with flowers and the Wearables logo. It's also controlled by a microcontroller, so it's smart fashion. And we had a problem now, because now we had two pieces. And we wonder, how can we synchronize many costumes? And it even got worse when Anya showed up and she wanted to have a dress with LEDs. And Anya, she's a performer, she's a dancer, she's a costume designer, but she knew nothing about LEDs. So we helped her to bring 60 wearlets to her costume. And this is Till, the partner, and he has the same costume, but it's just mirrored, yeah? So he has it diagonal from right to left, and he has it left to right. And together they perform a show with fire. So it's not only electronics, but it's also fire. And they call themselves In Love with Fire. Maybe you know them. They are quite famous in Berlin. They have fire shows. They go with the latest trends, and this they created everything. We only helped them with LEDs and with the programming. So now I had two performers who want to dance and they have to stay in sync. Yeah, and this means they have to trigger the costumes so that they show the same program at the same time. And this is almost impossible. And if you think about a performer that maybe he wants to improvise, he wants to have an interactive show with the audience, it's not possible if you trigger it at start time. So you have to react to whatever happens on stage. And so I thought maybe I should use a Raspberry Pi. Because I use a Raspberry Pi for everything, why not also use a Raspberry Pi for the costumes? I want to integrate the Raspberry Pi to each of those two costumes and control it with a laptop. And now you can imagine if you have a bigger show of 20 talents and they all have a Raspberry Pi and you can control them with a laptop. This means not only the two dancers, but also one person with a laptop that is like an artist that is interactive with the audience. It is reacting to what the audience does. And I used the Open Pixel Control protocol for this, and it's used in the Fade Candy project. This is software. You run it on the Raspberry Pi, but you can't really run it on the Raspberry Pi. So for this reason, I created some software. It's called WebSocket OPC. Yeah, WebSocket with the Open Pixel Control protocol. It is on GitHub. It's open source. If you have a Raspberry Pi, you can use it. It's very easy to set up, as you can see here. It's just opening a WebSocket, and your JavaScript HTML page can connect to this WebSocket. This is the source code for controlling the LEDs. If you're not a programmer, find a programmer who can help you. But for a programmer, this is really kindergarten. Yeah, this is JavaScript. Everybody in the world can do JavaScript. So you can control, you can program your fashion project with JavaScript. This is Node.js. So is this the Internet of Textile Things, or IoT for wearables? It is in a way, but it is more for the stage. I want to bring the costumes to the internet, to open it to everybody, not only the people in the room. If you have a video show, you can even let people from the internet decide what happens with the costumes. And for this reason, I tried datasparkfun.com. You can push your data there. This means it is basically a web database. You can create a stream with some sensor data, for example, temperature, and then post and push data to this channel. And of course, you can also listen to other people's data because it's all open, it's public streams. And my tie, it visualizes the radiation level in, I don't know, somewhere in the United States. So this is a random background radiation somewhere in the United States that is live on my tie because I have a Raspberry Pi in my pocket connected to my Wi-Fi over there. So think about the possibilities. If you connect your clothes to the internet, you're not limited to what you think beforehand. So you don't have to program the whole show. You can have an interactive show listening to data from the internet. And this makes fashion part of the Internet of Things. So what is next? I think the Internet of Things is a nice idea. But I met Jasna Rock. This is this duo from Belgium. We met at the Fashion Hack Day this weekend, and they are a great duo doing wearables and fashion tech. This is the mask that they created with a technology department in Belgium, and it's just from the lab. This is research, but we want to bring it to the fashion world, and we want to bring it to your wardrobe, yeah, so that everybody can wear it on the streets. This mask, it is connected wirelessly to a controlling laptop that just does the same open pixel control protocol that I just showed earlier. And you can now visualize everything on the mask. And the mask is is combined with a dress that is part of their collection. This looks like a simple dress, but it's not. they are using the latest materials. If I would pour some water over the dress, it is not impressed. The water just falls to the floor. It doesn't get wet. It's nano-coated. And this is what I like about the Jasna Rock team. They play with the latest technology, not only with electronics, but they also play with materials and the community. And I'm very happy to have more projects with them in the future. So thank you on the stage. So one other what's next question is, so what's next with my books? Wearables, intelligente Kleidung modisch gestalten will be the next big book about DIY wearables, again at O'Reilly. The co-author already introduced her, Lina Vasong over there. So we are into lily pad Arduinos and everything that Adafruit has, everything that SparkFun has in the shops, everything that Elector has in the shops. So it will be in print soon, because we have to give the manuscript next week. And for Maker Faire Berlin in September, it will be in the stores, and we will have it. Yeah, we will show you the examples live on stage at Maker Faire. So thank you. I'm open to questions now. And I also think that Jasna Rock might come back to the stage if you have questions for, yeah, about the mask or the dress. So thank you and enjoy Republica.
Are there any questions?
Thank you. Anybody not speaking German here? Okay, dann kann ich auf Deutsch fragen. Das ist eine ganz praktische Frage. Kann man die Textilien mit, oder die Wearables in Textilien waschen?
Man kann sie waschen, die gehen dann kaputt. Aber nee, Spaß beiseite. Es ist tatsächlich so, das ist natürlich die häufigste Frage. Ich habe die Sachen schon oft vergessen abzumachen. Und dann habe ich sie mit in die Waschmaschine geschmissen. Das ist nicht so gut, das klappt so 3-4 Mal. Handwäsche klappt besser. Naja, und die Jacke haben wir seit 2009 auch mal gewaschen, aber chemische Reinigung, ganz klar, ja. Also das ist nichts für die Waschmaschine, aber das macht man mit so Fashion-Sachen eigentlich eh nicht. Die LEDs selber sind wasserdicht, das ist kein Problem, aber die leitenden Textilien, die fangen an zu rosten. Ja, das ist das Problem. Wenn wir jetzt noch bessere Coatings bekämen für diese leitenden Materialien, dann hätten wir das Problem gelöst. Die Elektronik ist da recht robust, das ist eigentlich kein Problem.
Really no one who speaks English, don't understand German? Okay, frage ich in Deutsch. Kannst du die Sensoren sozusagen, dass du die abkoppeln würdest, dass du es nicht mehr miteinander verbinden würdest, indem du sozusagen einen kleinen Energieproduzenten, wie groß wäre der, oder habt ihr das mal durchgerechnet, dass er einfach sagt, die LED, die ja sehr wenig Energie verbraucht, wird mit einem Mikroakku oder Kondensator und einem kleinen Generator versorgt und wird dann funkmäßig angebunden? Habt ihr die Überlegung schon mal gemacht?
Ja, da gibt es natürlich viele Projekte. Wir haben früher viel experimentiert mit anderen LEDs, die wirklich sehr low-energy sind. Die, die wir jetzt einsetzen, brauchen dann doch ein bisschen mehr. Deswegen klappt das damit gar nicht. Der Mikrocontroller selber braucht auch viel. Und wenn ich jetzt auch noch über den Raspberry Pi rede, der braucht natürlich ein gutes Ampere auf 2 bei 5 Volt. Damit klappt es nicht mehr. Aber ich glaube, das ist auch das, ich möchte eigentlich weg von diesem low-energy. Ja, weil eigentlich brauche ich keine low-energy. Ich habe einen 10.000 Milliampere Stunden Powertank in meiner Hosentasche und keiner sieht es. Und für eine Party ist das eigentlich perfekt auf dem Laufsteg. Wenn ich 2 Stunden das Model hin und her schicke, reicht das ja auch wunderbar. Da brauche ich gar nicht so viel Energie. Also ich wüsste noch nicht so ganz genau, warum man die Energie sparen möchte. Aber es gibt sicherlich medizinische Anwendungen oder sowas, wo man wirklich Daily Use, aber da gibt es Lösungen, ja? Also die wirklich dann über Piezo-Effekte oder andere mechanische Effekte was machen.
Vielleicht wäre es bei OLEDs dann interessant. Ja, wirkliche Displays.
OLED auf Wearables, das ist auch noch ein Traum von mir, genau, ja. Ja, ja, weitere Fragen noch? Ein paar Minuten haben wir noch. Vielleicht noch zu Jasna, oder? Ja, dann Dankeschön.